Hello, everybody. I'm Randy Massaro, coming to you live in studio with a special guest that we have today, Mr. Robert Lanthier. For those of you that don't know me, my family made it big with the reality show Mob Wives. I also was in the TV series Border Battles and the Wiley Drake Show, amongst other films and TV shows. But the reason why we're here today is we get together with various celebrities, and in fact, today we're honored to be part of representing the Bowen Ranch out in Apple Valley, and also in the Apple Valley Happy Trails Parade. So it's an honor to be out here today, and we're bringing some super guests from Hollywood. Mr. Lanthier, I'm gonna go ahead and introduce you to him right now. He's gonna tell you all about who he is, what he is, and where he comes from. So, ladies and gentlemen, please welcome my dear friend, Mr. Robert Lanthier of The Real Cowboys.
Here I am. All right, thanks for the invite. I really appreciate it. Really enjoyed the parade that we were in today. And
tell me about yourself, Rob. Where were you born? Where'd you come from? In other words, besides being a Hollywood actor, tell us about Robert Lanthier, the person, and lead us into what brought you to Hollywood from Canada.
Well, I was born in Canada in 1950, and when I was 3 years old, my mom and dad and I, we moved from Quebec, Canada to Massachusetts, and that's where I grew up, in Massachusetts. But when I was 20 years old, having left Canada only at 3 years old, I decided to give Canada a break and go back there to see if I liked it better. But then 2 years later, my dad sent me some paperwork. My mom and dad became naturalized citizens in 1959. And the judge told my mom and dad at that time, well, I can have your son become a citizen, but, you know, I'm not going to do that because when he's 21 years old, he may want to go back to Canada. So that was pretty cool. But I went back there when I was 20 and I enjoyed it. That's where I met my future wife at that time. And 2 years later, my dad sent me some paperwork that I had been drafted into the Army.
Congratulations.
So I called up the Army and I said, well, I don't have to join the military if I don't want to because I'm still a Canadian citizen. Okay. And they said, well, that's true for, you know, for what you said, we believe you and everything. So we, you know, that's fine. I said, but since I grew up in Massachusetts, I'm going to do my patriotic duty and I'm going to go back to Massachusetts a month from now. Let me take care of my things I got to do here and I'm going to join the Air Force. So I joined the Air Force, got my training at Lackland Air Force Base in Texas. Then I got married and I got transferred to George Air Force Base, Victorville, in 1972. So when I got out here, I said, hey, there's no snow out here. I mean, growing up in 30, 40 below zero with 25, 30 feet of snow fall every year and shoveling the driveway and, oh my God, it's just not my thing. But I've been here ever since. I did 5 years in the Air Force during the Vietnam War. And when I got out in 77, my wife and I, we already had a small daughter. She was born at George Air Force Base. We moved to Burbank. Then I opened up a hobby shop, radio control model airplanes, boats, cars, and I ran that for 26 years.
Wow.
And then I left that. And but during that time, I was doing some acting in movies. I never was really a big actor. I did a movie with Rock Hudson and Brian Keith called World War III. I played a Russian in that picture.
Do you speak Russian?
Nah.
Oh, как поживаете?
No. Okay. No. Okay. But anyway, I speak French fluently.
Okay.
But and then I did a movie with Sylvester Stallone called Fist.
Oh.
That was my first thing I worked with. Yeah, it was a good movie.
Oh my God.
And then I did an episode of the A Team. And I forgot the name of this one movie. I worked a picture. I played a cop.
How many movies have you done in Hollywood over the years? Because you've
been
a long time.
But these are all small parts. Okay. And small parts.
So bit role acting, basically.
Yeah, okay. For now. I was up in Paul Apprentice, who's married to Richard Benjamin. I played a cop in that picture. It was a small part. But then when I was going up for some big parts, well, I'm sorry to say this, folks, but when it comes to Hollywood, down it goes, as far as I'm concerned. But I'm going to be doing a lot of acting because I'm going to be producing my own stuff, my own movies. I wrote a script, my first script, and I have one of my friends here who is one of the Real Cowboys. You'll be speaking to him shortly, and he's going to be working in a movie. And I got it's called Montoya's Betrayal. I wrote the story, and it's a good, clean, wholesome Western set in 1883. And the lead character in my movie was going to be my good friend Trini Lopez. Sadly, he passed away last year.
I'm sorry.
So I'm looking for another Latino actor that'll fit the bill. But I've got actor Barry Corbin, and it's looking good. I'm going to have Kevin Sorbo, and I've got Monty Markham, and I've got Rosie Greer is going to work in it. I got Patrick Wayne, John Wayne's son, Hank Garrett, who used to be on the old TV series years ago, Car 54, Where Are You? And those of you that remember the movie that Robert Redford did called 3 Days of the Condor, what he was being tracked to be killed by the government. Well, one day there's the mailman knocking at the door, and he had a box, and the mailman came in. He tried to kill Robert Redford. A fight ensued, and then Robert Redford kills the guy. And the guy was Hank Garrett, who's going to be playing the preacher in my movie. And it's going to be great. And I'm working on getting Scott Baio and also Ricky Schroeder to work in my picture, my Western movie. It's a good, clean, wholesome movie. And people will really enjoy it. And it's the first time I read a script. And everybody that's going to be working it that read the script, they just absolutely love it. They said it's you can't wait to get to the next page. I'm not patting myself on the back. It's just that I wrote this script in just 14 hours and 48 minutes. I was doing like 10, 15 minutes every night before going to bed. I hand wrote it. And my good friend that's here with me, you know, we retyped it on a computer because he has a program on a computer that does that, even tells you the length of time each scene is in the movie, how many seconds or minutes it took for that one scene. And my good friend Mike Shanto, and he's with here right now. And everybody loved, and I would write it 10, 15, 20 minutes at night, and everything just flowed and flowed and flowed. And then by the time I got done with it, it's a 2 hour and 15 minute movie. And by the time I got done with it, it was 142 pages. And when I added up the minutes, I had to do it 4 or 5 times, so I couldn't believe it came out to 14 hours and 48 minutes.
Oh my God.
So, you know, first of all, I'm also a pastor. And whenever I ask the good Lord to give me a hand to do something, he does. And like I said, the story flowed and flowed. And I never had to sit there and say, God, I came to a stop. I don't know what's going to be coming up next. I don't know what's going to happen next.
It sucks you in. It pulls you in. You just want more.
That's it. Right? Well, you know, our Father is fed up with the filth and garbage and the F words and the nudity and all that garbage and everything that comes out of Hollywood. I'm sorry, but that's where Hollywood is at these days. So, I mean, we're going to be doing something a whole lot better. Also, I'm involved in another movie. We're working on getting the money for that one there. It's about the famous Flying Tigers in World War II. And I knew 11 of the original 100, including one by the name of Pappy Boyington. Those of you that heard who he was.
Yeah.
A TV series was done about that back in the early 70s with Robert Conrad.
That's right.
Baba Black Sheep. Mm-hmm. But anyway, enough of that. I belong to an organization called Real Cowboys. That's R-E-E-L, Cowboys. And that's realcowboys.org for those of you that want to look us up. It started in November of 1996. I joined 2 months later. I've been with the organization since January of 1997. I'm the fourth president of the organization. The first one was for 4 years. The second one was 1 year. The third one was, he was a president. His name was, it's going to come to me, Baron Castle. That was his name. He was the president for 9 years and 2 months, but he was getting along in age, and I was the vice president, so he turned it over to me. But for some reason, the Cowboys keep voting me in every year, so I'm going to be going to my 13th year as being the Real Cowboys president.
Well, I find you amazing because you have every superstar's number at your fingertips. I know you were saying about the Real Cowboys had to be canceled because of COVID-19.
Twice.
But yeah, and we're going to honor, what, Tom Selleck, Wes Studi, Denzel Washington, Rosie Greer. Tell us a little bit about some of the superstars that belong to the Real Cowboys. I know you mentioned Rhonda Fleming, Stella Stevens.
Robert Fleming, Stella Stevens. We've got John Voight. We've got Morgan Freeman. We've got Lou Gossett Jr., Lou Diamond Phillips. We've got Connie Stevens, Stella Stevens. I mean, I can go on and on and on. We had Ernie Borgnine. By the way, we also have, those of you out there, ever heard of Sheriff Joe Arpaio? from Maricopa County, Arizona Sheriff.
Yes.
He's also an honorary member of the Real Cowboys.
So in other words, well, the Real Cowboys, now let's explain what Real Cowboys really means. We're Hollywood actors, but we're preserving the West, the way it was, the morals, the ethics, the values of the West.
Right.
And elaborate on that a little bit.
That's
Robert.
Right. Well, the thing of it is, a lot of our cowboy members have acted and still do act in movies, but we have a lot of members that have never been actors in any movies of any kind or Westerns or anything. But because they love what we are, of what we do, you know, the Real Cowboys, we have a major place in our heart for our veterans and our men and women in service today, and also the law enforcement, and also the first responders and the firefighters. I mean, we honor them every year.
So it's a patriotic, if you want to call it an actors association, but even you don't have to be an actor, belong to it, because there's real cowboys that aren't actors that belong to it.
Yeah.
People that take an interest in our country, in the pride,
yeah.
What America stands for, the morals, the ethics, the values, like you mentioned, Hollywood. Years ago, and I hate to say this, it seemed to be like when the mob was involved in Hollywood, everyone had class. Everyone dressed in their tuxedos. You didn't see the ripped up clothes and the cursing, anything like that. Today, it's changed, obviously. And they say you got to change with the times. And that's what they told about, that's what our parents said about us when we were growing up. But don't you agree that Hollywood years ago had class?
Oh, God, yes. I mean, one of my friends, I mean, we didn't hang out. I mean, we'd see each other once in a while. And he was such a great guy. And every time I saw him, I would snap to attention and salute him, because he served in World War II as a bomber pilot. And he ended up being a one-star brigadier general. And that man I'm talking about is Jimmy Stewart.
My God.
Jimmy Stewart was
one of the all-time greats.
All-time greats. I've met Clint Eastwood several times, another great. One time a friend of mine invited me, I don't want to elaborate too much. A friend of mine that I had met in Hollywood, he knew everybody. His name was Vince Barbie. He was an Italian actor, and everybody knew him. Unbelievable. So one day he called me, he could never drive a car. He called me on the phone one day. He said, "Hey, Bob, but what are you doing tomorrow?" I said, "Well, not too much." He said, "Good." He said, "Come and pick me up. We're going to go to Newport Beach. We're going to go to a big party, big barbecue. We're going to have some fun."
This is a French Canadian acting Italian. Mud on, manga.
But anyway, yeah, if you look him up, Vince Barbie, B-A-R-B-I, you'll
Vince
say,
Barbie.
Wow. Yeah, yeah. But anyway, we get there. And we had to stop at this place, and there was a limousine to pick us up with a few other people. And we ended, this is at Newport Beach we went to. So we ended up going on this boat, which was a converted minesweeper. So anyway, I'm on the boat, Vince is on the boat, he has a little glass of wine, I have a beer, and there was girls in nice bikinis and all that. They were cooking swordfish on the barbecue grill. It looked like steak they were cooking. So I'm leaning up against a railing like this here, and there's the stairs going down below deck. After about 10 minutes, I felt a little vibration. I looked down. Some guy was lumbering up the stairs, and he was wearing one of those Greek fisherman hats, okay? Comes up the stairs, and Vince was standing right there, and I'm standing right here by the rail. By the time the guy got to eye level with me and Vince, he goes, "Well, how you doing, Vinny? Well, I'm glad you came to my party." And Vince says, "Glad to see you again, Duke." And then Vince says, "Well, that's my good friend, Bubba Lanthier. I'm introducing him to you." Well, and Duke said, "Well, put it there, partner. Any friend of Vinny is a friend of mine." We didn't have cell phones back then to be able to have pictures taken. We're talking 1977. Then Duke passed away 2 years later.
Right.
And never dreaming that for a number of years until he passed away in 2003, his oldest son, Michael Wayne. He passed away. We were good friends, and now I'm good friends, of course, with Patrick Wayne, who's also a member of the Real Cowboys. Anybody that goes on realcowboys.org on the computer, and you punch up the word members on the menu on the side there, well, get ready to enjoy yourself to see all the people that are in there. Just totally amazing, the people that we have in our organization. And, you know, Robert Carradine and all those people, they're all part of the group. I got so much people, Billy Zane, as a matter of fact, Chris Christopherson, He's also a member of the Real Cowboys, yeah.
Well, let me ask you, Rob. Yeah. You know, people are looking at us, and like I said, it's a times are changing these days. Obviously, the classic movies, High Noon, How the West Was Won, The Wild Bunch, Sam Peckinpah's movie. What a great director. I mean, and yet the critics hated The Wild Bunch. It was so violent, and yes, it had nudity.
John Ford was a good director, too.
John Ford, yes. I mean, you know, there's many great Westerns and many great directors, and obviously, I think we lost, I think, the interest in the West. Obviously, we've gone other places in Hollywood. Yeah, Dances with Wolves. Every once in a while, a great one comes out. But I want to elaborate on the fact that we lost some of our Hollywood actors. And who brought us together was Johnny Crawford from The Rifleman.
Yes.
My dear friend. I got him involved in animal rights because, as you know, even though I may not be known in Hollywood as a big-time actor, I'm a small-time bit role actor. My family made it big with the mob stuff, but I also became a law enforcement officer. I want to make it clear that everyone calls me up, oh, you're the mob guy. I'm not. My family had a reality show, Mob Wives, about the mob, that growing up in a mob family. But anyway, the simple fact that I became a bit role actor and an animal rights activist. So a lot of the actors are now giving back because of the wild horse roundups that's taking place, the killing of the wolves. We're losing our heritage, not only as people, but as a nation. The pride that America cared at one time. We were patriotic about the flag. We cared about each other. We talked to each other. Now we're on computers. We're on texting. We have cell phones. Do you see what I'm saying? We're losing touch with that personal, repertoire between each other, where you walk down the street, you said hi, you shook hands, you knew your neighbors. You move into a neighborhood, you don't know anybody anymore. Back in New York, where my family is from, in Brooklyn, we knew who belonged in the neighborhood. Robert, you're from Canada. Was it any different in Canada? Did you know everybody? Were French Canadians? You hear about French Canadians?
Oh yeah. When I went back when I was 20 years old, in the town that I was living in, not far from Ottawa, everybody knew everybody. Everybody was friendly. It made no difference what color you were and stuff like that. There was, you know, some up there and everything, and everybody was joyful and happy and everything, and celebration all the time, and help each other out. And a lot of the places over there in Canada, one neighbor to another, there is no fence in between them.
But can you agree the times have changed where it's not as it was yet, you know, in years past?
Times have changed because of this. This. When I was a kid, I did things with my hands. I would be building model airplanes, model cars, did stuff three-dimensional, or did some drawings. I did a picture of John F. Kennedy when I was 18 years old. When I was, I did a picture with George C. Scott called Movie Movie. I had a small part in it, but he was really nice to me. And well, what I did, it took me 2 months. I did an oil painting of George C. Scott as General Patton.
Oh.
And I was able to hand it to him personally.
Really?
Yeah. Vince Barbie was right there behind me.
God.
And I've got it. It was at Warner Brothers Studios. And pictures were taken with a real camera. But today, I see kids, I see little toddlers sitting in a shopping cart, still wearing a diaper, and they're like this on the cell phone. This is the only thing that kids today, they have no imagination of anything. Well, you know, it's the parents' fault. Take the darn thing away from them and buy them a plastic model kit or whatever, and teach them to do something.
Kids emulate their parents, but I want to get back to something. Johnny Crawford brought us together because we all love Johnny dearly, and I got him up here in the Apple Valley Happy Trails Parade, and I'm so glad to have President Robert Lanthier of the Real Cowboys with us, Mike Shanto, another dear friend of ours, and obviously we lost Saginaw Grant as well, a proud Sac and Fox Native American who was in Breaking Bad and The Lone Ranger. He also joined me in the animal rights movement. I had the pleasure of meeting Clint Walker, one of the nicest guys.
I knew Clint.
I love Clint and his wife, Susan Cavallari.
Mm-hmm.
I met Ernie Borgnine as well. We spoke a little Italian. He had gotten back from Italy. I was wearing my Italian shirt. And he says, hey, are you Italian? I says, hey, come stai? Che si dice? Che fa? You know, we started speaking Italian.
Great guy.
All these actors are gone. So ladies and gentlemen, let's not take for granted the person that's next to us. You know, whether you just got to know him as a friend, let's not take the word friend lightly, because tomorrow they may not be here. Chuck Connors of the Rifleman. God, you gotta love Chuck Connors. He was such a talented person. Chuck was, he played for the Brooklyn Dodgers. He played for the Montreal Royals. He played for the Chicago Cubs. He played for the Boston Celtics. I mean, a shout out to these people. And I want to give a little shout out really quick to Michael Franzese, former mob boss of the Colombo crime family. You want to go to his son's pizza place in Newport Beach. Michael Jr. opened up Slices Pizza in Newport Beach. Michael, I love you, by the way. I see your Mob Mondays all the time on YouTube. And we're all connected back east with us Italians. But let's get back to the West and Robert real quick. Real quick.
Not only that, Chuck Connors' son, Steve, is a member of the Real Cowboys.
Yes. Oh, Steve was talented. He played for the California Angels.
That's right. And only that, too. This would have been Chuck Connors' 100th birthday year this year. He was born 1921. Now, also the Real Cowboys. We produce every year our very own. We've been labeled as the Oscars for Westerns. We're known in 188 out of 209 countries around the world. I produce and direct a show called the Silver Spur Awards Show every year. And in 2019, we honored Robert Crawford, Johnny's brother. Johnny was there that night. Okay, so every year we produce the show. Next year, 2022, is going to be September 16th. It's in the San Fernando Valley. It's at a place called the Airtel Plaza Hotel, right next to Van Nuys Airport. We can hold 300 people. Next year, we're honoring Rosie Grier, actor Monty Markham. If all goes well, we might be able to have Sam Elliott, Tom Selleck. Possibly, we're working on her, Jane Seymour. Any of you ever heard of a guy named Terrence Hill? How about the movies Trinity? They Call Me Trinity. Trinity is still my name, Italian spaghetti western. This guy is so famous. His real name is Mario Garotti. But Terrence Hill, and he had a big galoot of a guy with him called Bud Spencer. They were like the Abbott and Costello of the comedy westerns. Well, Terrence Hill lives in Massachusetts. He would have been glad to come this year, but doesn't matter, we couldn't do it. But he was in Italy filming a movie. He said, check with me early next year. He is he's won many, many awards in Italy, but he's never gotten an American award. So that's why it's gonna mean so special to him to be able to get this award next year, the Silver Spur Award. So, and also,
Denzel Washington?
Yes, I'm working on getting Denzel Washington
to come. West Studi.
West Studi also, yeah. So was, you know, West talked to me on the phone. He lives in New Mexico. And he said, Robert, I can't make it this year. This is before we had to cancel again. Right. He said, I'm going to be, you know, in another area of the country during that time. He said, check with me next year. I would love to get West Studi because he's really quite a good actor. And the thing of it is, this Silver Spur Awards show, what it is a charity event. A charity event that every year we raise the money and the net proceeds go to a foundation or to help somebody. Like we've done battered women and children. We did the City of Hope. We did the Let 'Em Ride Foundation.
Yeah.
Remember Lacey J. Dalton?
Lacey J. Dalton.
Yeah, we did that for her one year. We did also the Johnny Carpenter Arena. That's in Sun Valley. In the San Fernando Valley.
Let me throw this in. Lacey J. Dalton has also been doing things to help save the wild Mustangs as well.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. And the thing of it is, Johnny Carpenter always had kids that were like Down syndrome or they weren't quite with it. And he would strap them to horses and stuff like that so they could ride the horse and give them some little extra fun. So that way, when they're always in a wheelchair to look up at people, now they're sitting on a horse looking down on people,
right,
and they're getting a whole new perspective. Well, this coming year for the Silver Spur 2022, September 16th, the benefit that we're doing it for this coming year is going to be for the Gary Sinise Foundation, who helps veterans. He builds homes. He builds homes for the veterans, you know, for the ones in wheelchairs. And that's what we do primarily. And we have a Saturday morning breakfast, and it's right off the 405 freeway in Van Nuys on Roscoe Boulevard, and it's called Lulu's Restaurant, and that's where we meet the first and third Saturday. And you never know what big star may show up that weekend to those two weekends. So there you have it right there. I don't know how much more I can say, but go to realcowboys.org and you'll really, really enjoy yourselves. Like I said, we're here to continue the Western genre. And after, since 1997, that's 24 years, 25 years, 1996, we're still going strong.
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm Randal Massaro. And again, my guest is president of the Real Cowboys, R-E-E-L, Real Cowboys. Mr. Robert Lanthier, he's my friend. I'm proud to call him a friend and also be a part of the Real Cowboys. Thank you very much for joining us today, Robert. Can we get